Thank you. Eternal life. Amen. Psalm for today is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Our second lesson is from John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the weeks since Richard's passing, there has been an outpouring of sentiment from friends, former classmates, colleagues, and family, both formal and surrogate. It has at times been overwhelming, but always joyous and welcomed. It is no surprise to us that Richard leaves a legacy that reaches deep and wide.
We have been blessed to hear from his oldest friend, who grew up across the street from the Nault's. From those who knew him in high school and in college, we have heard from former fourth and fifth grader students of Dex who still connected with him 50 years later. One former student told me that he kept all the report cards from his 2 years in Dex's classroom because he cherished the personal notes that Richard had written to him. Others came into his life later on at Wash U and of course through Miami University in Oxford. He has many names to many people. Richard, Rich, Richie. Tour of Miami, or a few words of encouragement he once gave them. Others noted acts of kindness and compassion during moments of personal distress, reaching out to a freshman struggling against homesickness, being there for a student upon the death of a parent. Still others spoke of life-changing decisions that were in part attributable to Richard's guidance, pursuing a career in student affairs or entering seminary. In my own case, I owe my gratitude to Richard for my Episcopal faith. I also owe him for the gift that is Miami University, having decided without hesitation in 1984 that I would go to Miami for college. He was in his first or second year with the honors program here, and I was in fourth grade. A central point in every good story we've heard is how Richard made them feel, how he made each of us in that moment feel as if we were the only person in the world. He would validate our choices and offer his wisdom. He knew how to inspire, when to comfort, and how to support. So while the grief we each feel for Richard's passing is deeply personal, there is a collective need to come together today as a community to celebrate his memory and his life. In planning for today's service, we are grateful to Lori Clark, a member of the group of former Miami students known as the Hoops Group. Lori and my uncle traveled to Assisi, Italy for a retreat following the footsteps of St. Francis. She spoke of how important that retreat was to Dick and how he would pull out the prayer of St. Francis each time she visited him. Reading the prayer, I was immediately struck why this particular prayer would be so important to him, making this prayer a natural choice then to read as one of today's lessons. The prayer is at once simple and powerful, just like Richard. It is a call for personal action. Let me sow love, let me sow faith, let me sow hope, and let me sow joy. It emphasizes small acts for large impact. It is, in short, a script for how Richard lived his life each and every day, in every personal interaction. He was a quiet leader, leading not by talking louder or through grand gestures, but through sincerity and lots of listening. He knew the power of his words, and in this way, he was a gentle force in all our lives. He sowed faith, hope, light, and joy. He consoled, he understood, and most importantly, he loved us all. So I would like to end my remarks today with a challenge to each of us to commit small acts to honor Richard's legacy. In this way, we can carry on the light he left within each of us and cast it onto others. Here are some suggestions that I think would be meaningful to Richard. Greet everyone with a smile, not just those you know, but strangers at the grocery store, newcomers, even the postman. Call or Zoom with your older family members and friends on a regular basis, if not weekly, then monthly or quarterly. Give blood,
Even better, donate your platelets. Vote. Remember everyone's birthday. Call them or send a card or even just a text. Hold the baby. It will make you happy and the parents even more so to have a few minutes of peace. Show genuine interest in others. Ask lots of questions. Remember their children's names and most importantly, listen. Master a chocolate chip cookie recipe. Nothing sows love more than a fresh batch of Toll House cookies. The family wishes to thank everyone who has reached out these 3 weeks to share their stories and extend their sympathies. We especially thank those who reached out to him during the pandemic to make that personal connection he so craved and greatly missed. It brought him joy. We thank Reverend Horton and the Holy Trinity community for their support and pastoral care, both to Richard and to us in the weeks since his passing. Thank you.
It's quite an honor. He asked to say a few words for someone such as Dad. You know, I'm often asked why Episcopalians wear white. Why this is a white day. Aren't we grieving? Aren't we sorrowful? And yes, we are. But in our faith, today is an Easter day. Today is Easter. Today is the culmination of everything we believe in the resurrection and salvation. And it's a baptismal day, because in our baptism in the Episcopal Church, prison is marked as our beds. We are marked as Christ's own forever. Whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. And we celebrate the life that has been given to us to have on this earth. No matter how long or how short, we celebrate it because all life belongs to God. All life is a gift to you. And there are some people who make an incredible gift out of it. I'm going to be a little bit shorter in my homily because Aaron covered most of it. You know, I was not blessed to get to know Dick as well as everybody else, but I have come to know him and to understand the kind of person he was from the outpouring of grief and love and concern. Oh, and the stories of how he's touched people's lives. Everywhere he went, he touched somebody's life. That's amazing. And it's a gift. And it's precious. And when we lose someone like that, there's such a void. There's such a loss. The world is a little bit dimmer. We're a little bit less. You know, last Sunday's lessons for our gospel was about the bridesmaids. Bridesmaids and their lanterns. And some of the bridesmaids forgot to put oil in their lanterns, so they were stuck in the dark. And it's a gospel about light, always being the light in the darkness, the light that casts away the dark places. And you know, it takes a lot of work to do that. It takes a lot of work to be the light in the darkness, the light that casts away the darkness. It takes a lot of work. And then there are those few, those special ones, where it doesn't take a lot of work, because they don't even need lanterns. They are the light. It's in their DNA. Everywhere they go, they touch someone. Everywhere they go, they change the world a little bit for the better. stories of how Dick changed people's lives and touched them. Back as far as, wow, I can't even remember how far back. But you realize that he has left a legacy, all of those people. That not only has he changed their lives, but every person they come in contact with is a little bit changed, has a little bit more life in their life. Because he touched their souls. Because he was a light, and he did it in a way that never brought attention to himself, because he didn't know any other way. Those people are rare. And yes, when we lose them, the world is a little bit dimmer. Our lives are a little less bright. And as Aaron said, Dick would call us to something. A number of years ago, I kind of got stuck being the chaplain to a police and fire department. And I had to learn a whole bunch of things. And they had something way back then, before it was politically correct to say this, but it's appropriate for today. Man bands. You see those great big hoses that they have with all the pressure and the water in them? Well, there's one firefighter who's at the very front, directing all that water to the place where the fire needs to go. And behind that firefighter are all the others carrying the hose. Man down. The front firefighter goes down. The others are to step up and take his place. And as another goes down, the others step up and take his place. And in this world, we can't afford to lose any more light. Dick calls to us today, man down, step up, take my place. Be the light for me. Bring the light into the darkness. You know how I've done it. Your turn, man down. Now, I don't know if that's true in other services, but I know that it is true here with the firefighters, that we step in when there is a void. And I think that's what they would want us to do. Of course, it won't be as easy for us, but we can do it, because he showed the way. You know, in my faith, I believe that Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. I call you home. Your time on this earthly plane is finished. I call you home. And there is a place for you here. And can you see that? He's standing there, You are all the Lord's, and whether we live or whether we die, we will go and see those before us. And I'm hoping in those days that I get to know Jeff as well as all of you. And so, thank you for being here. Thank you for Jeff. I'm sure he'll tell you all to smile and be happy and be loved, because he's with the Lord. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
and life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us with your intelligence and dry the tears of those who weep.
Yes, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Yes, Lord.
You raised the dead to life and give to our brother eternal life.
Yes, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother to the joys of heaven.
Yes, Lord.
Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints.
Yes, Lord.
He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Yes, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Let light perpetual shine upon us. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our brother Richard, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that his death may recall to us your victory over death, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, through the ages of ages. Amen.